Welcome to the Department of Architecture and Urban Design at UCLA. We have a very special guest tonight, and I'm very much honored to introduce him today. I met him about 25 years ago. I was a student, like, kind of wandering in Japan. And like you guys, you know, I was really attracted by the beauty of architecture, right? The crafts, light and space and all those beautiful things, you know, make like an architecture of the hand. But at the same time, also, I was so much excited about the possibility of architecture, like a vision, like, you know, this future space and, you know, urban situations, cities and so on. But somehow those right hand and the left hand of the architecture really didn't match. I never seen that these two things kind of holding hand and happening in front of me. Either one is very conservative, even though it's really beautiful. The other one is too crappy, even though it's so much with a vision. So I went to, and I shouldn't say when, I came to Los Angeles, and then I met him, and I saw for the first time that I saw that the two hands of architecture were collaborating. Wolf Pricks, a co-founder, design principal, and CEO of Coop Himmelb, located in Vienna. In 1988, a Los Angeles office was opened, and he studied architecture at the Vienna University of Technology, Architecture Association of London, and the Southern California Institute of Architecture in Los Angeles. Most formative among his many international teaching positions was his tenure at the University of Applied Arts Vienna. From 1993 to 2011, he was a professor for architecture, Studio Prix, and also continued to serve as the dean of the Institute of Architecture. And without any further explanation, please join me to welcome Professor Wolf Pricks.
Thank you. Hitoshi, thank you very much. I'm honored to be here. Thank you for the kind introduction. Hey guys, good to see you. You threw me a great party the other night. I still have a hangover. Can I have a glass, by the way, please? Okay. Yeah. So, title of the lecture is What's the Difference? And I can explain it very shortly. In the first three rows, a lot of my old pals are sitting here. And I count on the short time memory of my friends, because they will see a lot of images which they hopefully know, Tom. But what's the difference? Yeah, a long time ago when my son started to study architecture, Zayak actually, he was a great musician, he was a great guitar player, and after a year he came to me and said, hey, Dad, I'm really fed up to have the John Lennon syndrome, meaning that all the people are asking me how you are doing. What should I do? Should I stay with architecture or should I go with music? And I said, okay, son, compare the first row of an architecture lecture with the first row of a rock and roll concert. So he went off and started to play guitar again. That's the difference. Nothing against you, but so thank you very much for inviting me. What's the difference too? I explained it already. People always tell me when I'm doing a lecture, please show some of your old project as well. And this I do now. 20 years of my professional life. Thank you. it's coming from, namely sky blue is not a color in my point of view, but the idea of having architecture buoyant and changeable like clouds. So back to the 60s, and this is very important. My role models when I was a young architect was not found in architecture. It was in other areas, like Che Guevara and Bob Dylan were much more role models for our work than Palladio or other unnecessary guys. Why? Because these two guys said very important sentence which could be translated in architecture. Like, let's be realistic, let us do the impossible. This is actually a very important sentence for young architects. Trial and error means that we are living in an open society which was created by the movement of enlightenment. And that's the great difference to all the other cultures around the world. I was wondering why I'm doing so hard negotiating and talking to Chinese people or to Arabic people in terms of architectural terms. I found out because these cultures, and this is not a good term, don't confuse that, it's not an evaluation, it's just a statement. This culture didn't have the enlightenment. So self-improvement and open systems are not experienced words for this kind of cultures. So let's be realistic, let us do the impossible is coming from this movement. Like the other one, don't follow leaders, watch the park you meet. There's a very famous quote of Dylan at this time. And this is still one of our most evaluated teaching system in our school. So the question is, what is architecture? The answer, or my answer, is yes. Because, and this is another thing, everybody is right. But you have to know that nothing, really nothing, is correct. I like this kind of lectures because I don't have to talk too much, but you have to read a lot. So what's the difference? Are we the iPad, or is this old guy with the beard the iPad? So what's the difference for?
Little boxes on the doorstep.
It's easy to see. These architectural pieces without, or you can see the absence of intelligence, you can see the absence of generosity, you can see a lot of timid way of thinking. The more general thing, the more intelligent thing, the more architectural spacey ideas we could find in this case study houses. So how can we get back to this generosity, intelligent way of thinking? My proposal is to expand the meter by 5 centimeters. Meaning you got increasing of the volume of 15%. How can we pay 15% costs 15% more? The building expense will increase by 50%. How can we pay? It's easy. If you calculate that the inflation is 5% per year, you have to build your building 3 years earlier. Something for the school. If you want to build a ship, this is it's my favorite sentence as a teacher. Actually, I retired this year, so I'm not a teacher anymore, but I'm still thinking that's the way we should teach our students. If you want to build a ship, don't drum up men to gather wood and distribute the work. Very important. But teach them a longing for the wide open sea. It's not only for shipping, sailing, it's also for architecture. And the other one, this is very important. You don't need development to know which way the wind blows. And this is right now more important than it was a long time ago. I'm talking about private and public space, public spaces. The other one was in China. This is in Mexico City, where 3,500 naked people are gathering on the Zocalo. And this is when public space becomes the point of departure. And here, public and private spaces are mingled up. It's funny to see that on these two pics, police or military is in the forefront in the public space. So, if we would not have a public space, where could we gather? Where can we meet in order to start a revolution, like, for instance, here on this place in Cairo in Egypt? I know that young people talking about city and public space say the public space is not on a place anymore. It could be in an airplane, or it could be on the internet when they are connected. Great idea. But if you have no place, maybe, of course you are placeless. Then you are homeless. And then, if you are timeless, placeless, and homeless, then you are clueless. Louder, please. So, what we have to do is to introduce new ideas which are not connected with traditional architectural terms or traditional architectural ideas, introduce new methods of the interpreting public space. That could be that we study, and this is a study we are working on right now, that we are comparing the synapsin, the working of synapsin with our cities in order to get new ideas and new point of departure for the reinterpreting the urban vision. I know this is we have the problem that the architect sits, and you have to face it in an ivory tower. And if you talk to the client, it looks like that. He will not understand you for sure. And if you read the theory we are doing, it looks like that. No one understands you. So my proposal is we should look on other fields how, for instance, an architect like Christopher Warden is presenting his model. No, come on. So this is the architect sitting in his office, waiting for the client. He wants to present his model. The client is ruining the pen. This is the model. We have to learn how to present our works like Christopher Wood is doing. I can imagine Tom Main dancing during the studio this much. I can tell you on this count, maybe. But we have to know that we are surrounded by mediocrity, and I have to tell you, mediocrity knows no respect at all. So therefore, we have to have seven lives like a cat in order to survive. The seven lives of an architect could read like that. Enough is not enough. We want more. And now you will see Che Guevara reading my text, Architecture Must Burn.
Raya Girón es la primera derrota del imperialismo en América Latina, pero también es una de las primeras derrotas del imperialismo en escala mundial.
For all people who are speaking Spanish, it was not the correct translation. Long time ago, intense fire in the middle of the city. In spite of all codes and rules, we always could convince code or ban the codes and rules, the building codes, the building rules, in order to get what we want. Then the second life is we have to know that architecture is not surface. It's content. If it would be only surface, then we would go with the Lady Gaga aesthetic, which is actually very shallow and pretentious. Do you remind, or can you sing, or do you know one line of her song? Not at all, but you know the very nice skins that she is wearing. So the Lady Gaga aesthetic leads exactly to the greenwashed buildings. No content, nothing new, just the rendering with a little new green on the balcony. That's really stupid. Because I think what we have to gain, and this is a very important thing, we have to gain the synergy between content and shape. It doesn't read form follows function or function follows form. It's nowadays, especially we have the tools to create that, nowadays that the outside and the inside is synergetic, mixed up. And then, I know you are the best, but now architecture is really a team game. It has to be in order to avoid the overcome of the investorial thinking. Look, this is the architect in the foreground looking at his client. So look, we are getting weaker every day. Yeah? The role of our the power of our profession is fading. So what we have to do, we have to invent new slingshots like David against Goliath in order to survive. Otherwise, our office will be look like this empty, out of order gas station because we are selling wrong fuel or wrong energy. There is a very nice poem in German, and I try to explain it in English. So the rhyme, because the German is rhyme, this is not the rhyme. German goes like that, the architect springt weit, warum auch nicht, hat ja Zeit. So that's, but the architect jumps far and wide because he has time enough. So I think Corbusian architectural offices, codes and rules are more or less over. What we did in the last half year, we reorganized, or I reorganized my office like the soccer playing of the most successful team in soccer worldwide, Barcelona. You know, Barcelona is playing a very rigid system on one hand. This is the fast passes, the triangle passes. But this would be a logic way to get to the goal, to gain the goal. So therefore, the trainer has two or three people who are playing street foot soccer, meaning not calculable movements, breaking this the logic of the triangle. And this is the way we work, and this is the way we design. So this is Messi, yeah? He doesn't care about the triangle. He is playing uncalculable moves. So this is like in evolution. If you do break the codes and rules, on a certain point, you create new innovations. Complexity, for me, is plan equals section equals view equals detail equals everything. And we have to remember, as the sixth life, that when the grid vanishes, the Gestalt. I don't know whether this is the same here in this country because of the language. Gestalt for us is much more than just form. Gestalt is a the psychic interpretation of the psychological interpretation or the psychic life of a shape, of a form. Yeah, this is like in a chess play. If the chessboard vanishes, yeah, the figures are not so important than the power of the move the figures can do. Yeah, and this is a very important thing. Take your time, but not too long. If you're fighting too long, maybe you lose it. But on the other hand, the Muhammad Ali's cross punch strategy is a very appropriate tool for urban planning, for instance, because the cross punch strategy foresees a problem before and solves the problem before it becomes a problem. When I'm talking about communication nowadays, I have to talk about our closed society and with their rules and regulation which prohibit the free personal development, whether you realize it or not. It happens every day, especially in our profession. And the response to replace emotion with programs, rules, and regulations, you could find in many, many, many schools and in many, many architectural offices. That really cannot be the end. Communication nowadays, yeah, the individual communication mostly goes like that. And there are a lot of images where students or our co-workers sitting next to each other but sending each other emails, not talking anymore. And the other way, the more positive way, yeah, if we compare a Stone Age hunter who is looking for the track of a deer in the desert, compared to this, we contemporary people who are able to find on an airport the right airplane which brings us at the right time to the right place, we are compared to this, the Stone Age guy is a simple-minded specialist. So I'm talking also about the possibility of the impossible things. Architecture is heavy, and the weight costs time and money, and we have today, I had a discussion with Eric about politics and architecture. But, you know, you cannot make architecture without politics, because architecture costs time and money. But you have to choose the strategy. You can be on the right place at the right time. I like that. I really like it. Because it's fate. Yeah? The strategy of fate, maybe we should teach, like dancing. Maybe we should make a new studio. Dancing studio and fake studio. When we talk about architecture, and this is a very important thing as well, yeah, this we are talking about the iceberg, yeah. We only discussing the visible part of the building, the invisible architecture, which is secretly under in the hidden, yeah, politics, constraints, law, codes, money. We never discussed it officially in a theoretical discussion. Never ever. But it's the more important thing. So what we see is form. Form could be explained like that. This is a hawk, beautiful bird, variety of shapes, variety of feathers. A goose, the prey of the hawk, sees this beautiful bird only as a cross, simplifying a beautiful, lively shape, simplifying to a cross. So if you simplify too much in architecture, boxes, then maybe you only have the view of the goose. So this is not a simple shape. It's a brancusi done in the 1920s. Combination of materials, shapes, forms, beautiful. When we started to work with the computer, Tom Wiscom remains that very well, I hope. We started to try to improve the complexity of a rigid program by doing things with break the system with hands. We're still doing that. But nevertheless, the program's getting better and better, and the form's getting more elegant, I would say. But sometimes, too elegant, maybe. The next thing is the entry of a competition of our school. A lot of my friends took part in this competition. It was an international competition, but we were thrown out in the first round. Guess from whom? From our friend Peter Cook. So this is a very complex, it was a very complex task. A lot of constraints. Anyway, so this is lost. I'm really angry about that, because the school, not because we didn't win, because the first prize was a retro prize of a kind of not so beautiful guy. So anyway, so how a dolphin becomes architecture? Like this. We took this piece on top of this sculpture, leaned it up a little bit, squeezed it, and then we sent it around the Mars, like the moon of the Mars, which circles around the Mars the wrong way. The science calculated it that it goes like the left once, but it doesn't go like this. It goes the other way around. It means sometimes logic is not logic. So we took it and squeezed it a little bit, and this part became a space divider in the middle of a Chinese project, namely the Museum of Contemporary Art and Planning in Shenzhen in China. Here you can see the two different museums connected by a platform and connected or separated at the same time by this sculptured sculptured space, which actually has a program, namely it's the library, the lecture hall, and things like that. grande, cioè, musica. It's Shenzhen is the port of departure of cultural buildings right now. Everyone is building in Shenzhen. This this project, this museum should be on site next year, I think, I hope, because the two directors of the museum, they are not familiar with each other. So they are fighting who can get more space on the right hand side, and this is my dolphin. Of course they have to speak Polish. By squeezing and enlarging this shape a little bit, a new museum came out. This is our entry for the National Museum in Beijing. Not by chance. It reminds a little bit on the dream of Dalian. This is the project. We proposed inside a three-dimensional the system of a Chinese garden, but in three dimensions. But they don't want to have a Chinese garden, they want Frank Gehry. Breaking the ground is one of the most, for me, it's one of the most important moments in my life, to be honest. Because this is the moment when ideas become reality. What you have in your head becomes reality. You can have a grip on it. I like that. So I show some of our projects we have on site right now. The one, the more geometrical, strategic, complex thing is the EZB, European Central Bank in Frankfurt. Three towers, two slabs in the middle, an atrium tower where we have hanging 50 meter high hanging gardens. So they will support the microclimate. It's a very complex structure, because it's a mixture between the Gaudi hanging construction and Gothic cathedral. And this is the way the building will move, actually. Not that extreme, but they have to fix it. Right now, they have to fix everything. We are in the 23rd level, meaning the heart. They have to fix everything because otherwise it would be not possible to build it up. So now what we have on the table for high rises look like this. This is an office building in Vienna. This is a hotel apartment complex in China. And what we have on site right now is concert hall in Aalborg in Denmark, surrounded by a music school. This is the idea of the gestalt of the music hall, of the concert hall. As you can see, it's not a shoebox, it's differentiated because of course, acoustical reason, but also because of sight reason. So it will look like this, and these water drops on the side are not only acoustical fixtures, but also windows so the students can look at the concert, and of course lighting fixture in order to give them a kind of floating idea of space. It's under construction right now. It will be finished, I think, in 2 years. The the longest last project is this. We won this competition in 2001, I think. And now we have it on site. It's a beautiful site, actually. It's where Ron and Søren come together. Now, the idea was to create a building like a flying roof in order to not prevent people from walking from the city to the nature. They can pass the building underneath. So, dynamic forces were at this time a very, very important issue in our office. And from this comes, of course, the structure, I have to say. Very complex structure, spatial and construction-wise. We did a lot of experiments. This is a separate lecture, actually. It will look like this, and for us, the underneath, the sixth surface were very important, so we took, we are taking care about the area underneath the building. So it's coming up. You wouldn't believe after 11 years or something like that. This is a detail, yeah, just to show how complex the things are getting together, and it's already on site. This is not under construction, it's finished. It's the Busan International Cinema Center for the International Film Festival. There are two parts. One is an open air cinema covered by a roof, and the other is the entrance area with the double cone for the stars and movie school and movie cinemas, many cinemas. You can see the two roofs. The one long extended roof is the longest cantilever in the roof of the world. It's about 85 meters. That's very, very long. During the construction, they changed the wind code because the wind getting stronger because of our climate change. Getting stronger, the hurricanes are from 200 miles to 250 miles. So they changed the wind code. The question was, how can we react? We had it already up. The choice was, should we put it down, reconstruct the whole thing, or should we introduce a strategic move, namely look at this little red hidden column in the ground. If the storm gets too heavy, it's coming up and holding the roof down from the right away. This is what I mean, the possibility of impossible things. So I have to tell, not the architecture is intelligent, it's the architect who is intelligent. So there are some pictures. It was a great opening. And of course, the roof is a horizontal movie screen. And a lot of people were visiting the opening. You can see how the dimensions are enormous. 6,000 people are under this open-air cinema roof. And this was the opening. I got the honorary citizenship of Busan, and when the mayor gave me the plaque, he said, okay, from now on you have to pay the tax here in Busan. Nice. Now we are moving to China, exactly to Dalian, on the Chinese Sea. And we have a project there that's a cultural center, it's a congress center, a combination with an opera. It's enormous. As you can hear, it really is in China. It should stop. The site is beautiful. We enlarged the site. We made the design for the landscaping around the buildings from young architect, as you can see. And we had to combine an opera building with a congress center, which was not that easy because it's functional and program-wise very different on one hand. On the other hand, it's the combination, the synergy is a great moment. The idea, where the shape comes from, is a very old idea. This is a project we did in the late 70s, early 80s, and we called it Open House, and I said, the feeling of the inside breaks, expand the skin of the outside. And it's the same way, the same method we used for this Congress Center. So we didn't want to build a simple cone, and it was height limit as well. So we pressed it down. It's easy, it's much better to do it with hand than on the computer, but anyway, so, and of course the Congress room spaces were pushed through the envelope, and we smoothed it up by a facade, which is a very intelligent facade, I have to say. This is the programming. There are, in the middle you can see the opera, and the yellow pearl ring outside are the Congress spaces, connected by a public space area. Of course, there on the interchange from this interchange level, you can go to the opera as well. The ramp is coming up, crossing the space and leading to the galleries of the opera building. I have to say building because it's like an aircraft carrier. And here you can see the pushing out Congress spaces. This is how it will look on the inside. Metal skin, stone floor, metal skin. Also the ceiling is metal, but very differentiated because of the lighting. We have natural light in this building. This is a climate concept, of course. I think I should later. This is working on the opera building. Very, very sophisticated acoustical conditions because they want to have a normal opera, but they also want to have electroacoustic events. So a lot of things we have to bring together that makes the whole inside very lively, I have to say, and very functional on the other hand. So this is the structure. There's about 400, instead of building 400 tanks, they had to build this concrete center. Yeah. Sustainability. A lot of steel is in this building. Better in this building, concrete and cultural building, than in tanks, I would say. The geometry of the facade, complicated, but very tough to build that in China because actually the expertise in doing the things is not so advanced. Not a black box, but a glass box with louvers, movable louvers. So, and they control the light, the shade, the inside. They block the view and open the view and a lot of other things. So therefore, the facades get very light. So this is the Chinese planning and on-site. And I have to say, this is one of my favorite topics. Corbusier said we had to make a building like a ship. I don't know whether he did it, but we did it. This is a part of the construction of Dalian done in a shipyard, because they were the only guys who could weld 10 centimeter steel plates. We did it a long time ago in a museum. We built the whole museum in a shipyard, brought it with the ship to the site and placed it on top of the other building. And this is a recently done project. It's a roof for a church. Some images of the construction site in order to show the really large dimension of this building. It's coming up. Takes a while, it's coming up. Inside, a little bit like the drawings of Piranesi, which I really love. And this is how it will look like, a space, floating space. Metallic floating space. A little bit like liquid mercury. And Anne is not here, but I would have made him a compliment. He's doing the mercurized chewing gum structure. This is heavy metal. So it's coming up, the roof, of course, you know, solar energy, blah, blah, blah. This is craftsmanship, yeah? No one should tell me that sustainability is so important now. All our buildings consume 30% less energy than the codes are asking. Now we are doing buildings which produce more energy than they consume. This is the next step. Doesn't look like Gaga's aesthetic greenwash. So, and almost the end, big building, small building. I think it's very important to do small buildings as well. And this is my hometown. It's a medieval town. I mean, I got the commission to do a little church, a very little church. It's about 80 square meters, 90 square meters. In my hometown, you can see in the middle, on the left side, this is the Catholic church, and here is the Protestantish. So, this is the church, the tower, and the room for praying, and the holy procedure, a lot of other supporting spaces around. Of course, the idea comes from somewhere, namely from my friend, Corbusier. I will do a lecture about Corbusier in a different way. On the other side, there is a medieval building on this, maybe I try it very carefully. So this one, yeah? This is a Romanischer, almost Gothic tower, kind of stone house. And the roof is curved, and we took this geometry from this roof and pushed it in our time, so to say, and modeled it and remodeled the computer drawings by hand, so to say, and then a roof came out. This is the model. And they chose the difference. The next step in Corbusier thinking, yeah? On top you can see this is a ceiling with holes and of course tubes on top of the roof, but it doesn't break through. Our light catcher are breaking through and sculpturing the ceiling. Done in the shipyard. Brought to 1,000 miles away, the shipyard, brought with big trucks to my home, a medieval hometown, in three parts, welded together, and then with the music of Stairways to Heaven.
To the moon.
this is how we use rock. This is done. It's done. Yeah? This is not a fake. This is a real photo. I like these snakes. I really like it because, you know, the baroque church on the right hand side, it's 200 years away. And the inside was very important for us. How to make it very sharp and very precise with all the bauphysikalischen, with all the building physics. So we used very precise, we used a very old strategy, very old craftsmanship technique. Building the inside and cladding for the plaster with reed. Yeah, reed? Understandable? Chief? Reed? Reed. Reed. Thank you. But you see what I mean. That's easy. So a very medieval point of departure, namely the geometry of the bone house, was mixed and mingled and interpreted in a very contemporary tool, and then built in both ways. Very modern in the shipyard and very old in a very old technique. Yeah, this is what it looks like. Look at this. Yeah, this is how Corbusier and Mies van der Rohe comes together. On the left, you see the light slit? Mies is doing the putting the roof on the wall like this on the left side. On the left side, this is Mies. On the right side is Corbusier, just in case you don't know. So Corbusier is lifting up the roof, make a joint with light, so to say, and make the roof fly. Who is more stupid? I don't know. So here, both ways, both thinking come together. You see this, it's very new interpretation. This is Corbusier, and now it comes to me is a little bit more than anything. So anyway, inside. And the table, the altar is done in the same geometry like the roof. This is the church could be, the room for prayer could be expanded by a sliding door. So, and now it's just for Richard. Are you still here? Yeah, you're here. Richard, this is what I would say the best interpretation of architecture, namely the imagination that the wind has embodied. Can you follow this thought? Namely, the wind and the whole thing is very good, because the wind gets embodied, it means it's dynamic, touching you, but it's, like he said, bodiless, but only bodiless as an object, not as a creature. That's great. That's my belief in architecture. So what could be, on base of this thought, architecture in the future? I think we have to deny gravity, we have to get rid of columns, and we want to have, of course, building hanging in the sky. Gravity? No, thank you. Since we are conquering the space, yeah, the monocentric Renaissance thinking of monocentric symmetry, it's obsolete. I think it's obsolete. And not by chance. If you lie down on Corbusier's chair, you have the same position the astronauts have to take when they overcome gravity. Not by chance. What I like is that we will do sometimes. We will generate structures by music. This is the rebirth thing. This is the roof of BMW interpreted in tone. I can imagine that we make the other, sometimes we can make it the other way around. Paulina is working on that, my structural engineer, a really good friend, Klaus Paulina. And I want to have materials like sound. And now I have to play one of my favorite licks of Keith Richard, playing in Gimme Shelter. You have to know that he is the inventor of the five-string guitar open tune. The invention of the Stones were the open-tuned five-string guitar, or in G minor, tuned guitar of Keith Richard. And he is playing the intro to Gimme Shelter, and you will hear, you have to hear very closely, you will hear the last tone. It's played on the second G-tuned string, and I can imagine this is a material, transparent, translucent, very strong, so you can build a high-rise with that, but wobbling and something around. So, listen, I will play it twice. It's beautiful. It's really beautiful. Okay, this is another a third studio I went to, about guitar playing and material. And I think we should introduce again other things, not following the boring architectural codes and rules, but we have to bring in and introduce from outside ideas in order to change the vocabulary of course, sometimes the urban planning as well. So we are working on a research program where we first, now we are in the state of comparing similarities of urban functions and the functions of our brain. And I showed it already, this is a research and an experiment how attractors could provoke new, like in our brain, if something is turning around or falls out, another district takes over. And since then, it's very long time till we get that. Thank you very much.